Hello, welcome. This is the 345th day making flasks today. Flasks are going to be an item where you die. You're the hero, you're dead. Your flask brings you back to life. It's full of spirits, as in liquor. Whoa, what was that noise? All right. So, where have I left off? What's up, Arcane? Howdy, man. What's up, Scottish Pizza? How you guys doing? Pretty good place to die. Oh, nice. Thanks. Thanks a lot, Pizza. Thanks for hosting, man. I appreciate it. I was wondering what that noise was. All right, cool. We could die there. I'll get the save set up so. Dark Souls 1 took you 42 hours. 20 hours on Dark Souls 2. Wow. Sweet Arcane. I'm only like 3 hours into playing Hyper Light Drifter, but oh my god, I love Hyper Light Drifter. What's up, Teek? You're addicted to Diablo 3? We're all addicted to something. Heck yeah. We're all addicted to some video game right now. Arcane's Dark Souls 2. I'm playing Hyper Light Drifter and you're addicted to Diablo 3. Let's turn on some initial hurt. Maybe let's try it too. Yeah, so today's thing is going to be flasks. These are an item where you can fill it up with spirits, and they bring you back to life if you die. Okay, cool. Good, I have. Very close to death there. Good. All right, so great. We got a little situation set up. We can start here on this screen and die quite easily because I got an initial hurt of 2 hit points. So basically, down to the bottom. Dead real fast. All right, so. Yeah, so all I gotta do is give the player a flask. Make sure it's full of spirits. And then code the stuff to make it so he comes back to life right here. So I'm thinking. Huh. Let's see the fear screen again. You hate that you can't play it for the first time? See that again. I think the timing is gonna have to change a little bit. So the screen goes black. Oh. Huh. Maybe actually we'll just you'll die. Think about whether, like, should you fall to the ground and die, and then just immediately your spirits work and you get back to life, or should it go to this all the way to this black screen here before he comes back to life? It kind of would be cool to see it all in, up close, I guess. Hmm. Well, I guess the easiest thing to do is to try the first one. Yeah. I haven't played Diablo 3. I played Diablo 2 and 1, of course. I loved 1, and I loved 2. I just haven't played Diablo 3, though. I haven't even played StarCraft 2. Can you believe that? Those were, like, the biggest games I played when I was a kid. StarCraft, Diablo, Warcraft, or Warcraft 3, sorry. Whatever it was. Was it Warcraft? Yeah, it was Warcraft. What was the one before Warcraft? Wasn't there something else craft? No, I guess it was just Warcraft, right? I can't remember my childhood video games. I'm doing good, man. You never played 1 and 2. Oh, for Warcraft, you mean? Yeah. Warcraft 3 was great. Wait, so was Warcraft 3 the one that was all 3D? Isn't that what it was? I'm talking about the old one where it was all 2D. That Warcraft was awesome. I loved it. We're complete. You know? Okay, so I'm just going to start off by making him so he gets right back up. So we'll go to the phase death. All right, this phase is where all this little magic happens, where it creates a new hero icon, has this layer that blends, has the message for fear and all that. So if the player enters the death phase, wait a second, is it running the hero's death right here? Animation? No, it's not. So the death animation is in a different place. I guess the easiest thing to do would be to change it in the system before I change it in the flux. You haven't played Diablo 2, any of those. Yeah, Warcraft 1, that's right. Yeah. Right? Warcraft 3 was like 2.5D. Man, I gotta get my Warcraft straight. This is so crazy. Which one was Warcraft 1, basically? Yeah, this is what I'm talking about. The 1994 version, for sure. Yeah, Warcraft 1. We're complete. Wait, was it? No, this is Warcraft 1. What? Is it? I don't know. I'm so confused. This might be the wrong images or something. Warcraft, Orcs and Humans. 94. Okay. Come on, Wikipedia. Yeah, it is this. Oh, this is the older one. Is it? Or maybe I just don't remember. No, this is it. Yeah. Dang, I forgot it had this like side menu and everything. Oh yeah, Warcraft 2 was Tides of Darkness, which was a bit technically an expansion pack. Oh, right. But yeah, same screen. And then Warcraft 3. Right. Warcraft 3 is when they finally went, this is like a 3D engine. Yeah. All right. I was talking about Warcraft 1 and 2. If you guys haven't played Warcraft 1 and 2, whoa, you should check it out. They're pretty good. And they're so awesome, old school, too. Okay, so yeah, the flux is probably not the best place to do this. This should be back in the health system. When the player dies, The player should just be able to use a flask. We gotta give the player a flask. Flask, 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 flask. Here it is. Flask one. We have one of them. There. Let's fill up all the flasks. Bam. All right. Now in the health system, when the player dies, hold on, does the hero have any collision switches? No. Nope, they don't. Okay, so we'll do this a different way. What do the flasks do? They bring you back to life. So what, they're like the fairy in a bottle from Zelda. No, the cacti heals you for one tooth and gives you invincibility for a little while too. And also reveals secrets. And also, it will reveal Zero, the new hero. There's a different hero character. Not a hero character, but more of a neutral NPC character. His name is Zero. He's the guy with the big horns from the Songbringer, you know, drawing and everything. That guy will sometimes appear when you take the cactuses. He'll just, like, magically appear because he's your spirit guide. But anyways, flasks bring you back to life. So once when you die completely, the flask will magically bring you back to life, a lot like a fairy did in Zelda. And it will get used up. So you'll drink up the flask, and it's empty from then on until you go and get it refilled at the store. So at the store, you can go buy more spirits and fill up your flasks. And you can get up to 3 flasks. So if you have 3 flasks, that means you can die 3 times and come back to life. I'm pretty sure with full health, too. So, yeah. They're a very valuable item. Very valuable. So finding a single flask is awesome. Finding 3 flasks in the world is amazing. Like, it'll be difficult to find all 3 flasks because they're such a valuable item. All right. Animate. I guess it's going to happen when the hero dies inside the health system on death. So do you have to drink it as a precaution? No. Just having them, you're totally passive. Just having a full flask just basically grants you a life whenever you die. You don't have to have used it right before you die. It's not that difficult of an item to use. But that's an interesting topic though, because it would definitely add some challenge to the game if you had to manually use them. But like, if there was some kind of timer, so you would drink the flask and then for the next like 10 seconds or whatever, if you die during those 10 seconds, then you brought back to life. That kind of sucks. I don't know. That kind of really weakens the flask. Makes it less. I would want to use it less as a player because I'd be like, damn it, I have to go equip the flask. I have to use it at just the right moment. And if I don't use it, if you don't use it right in those 10 seconds, then you'd have to, you'd have wasted a flask, which would really suck. So I think making keeping them passive was probably the best way to go here. Unless if anybody else has some opinions, please share. There we go. On the player death. Run to flux death. Unless, if we have a flask, come back to life. E-gear count. Flasks. Well, there's no count flasks. I've got to write this function. I was thinking that the flask would give you like a 2-minute window and you would have to decide if you want to drink it before a difficult boss or something. Huh. That would definitely loosen it up and make it a lot less challenging to use. And it would probably, I guess, reward the player a little bit in that you would feel pretty smart if you had used one and died during those 2 minutes. But if you, once again, if you do use the flask and you don't die in those 2 minutes, then you will have wasted a flask, which is, I want them to be sort of a really precious, valuable item, you know? So if there's something that you kind of have to waste, I can see people hoarding him a little bit more instead of using them. And I like to see people using the items that are in the game rather than hoarding them. You know what I mean? Or a 10-minute duration? Yeah, well, that's what this really is. It's a pure passive death evasion, but it's not something that you're going to get every time. You know, it's not something that's in the direct path of the player. You have to go out of your way to earn one of these flasks. Well, I guess I was kind of thinking of the way it worked in Zelda 3. Zelda 3's Fairy in a Bottle. You know? That worked for me. When I played Zelda 3, I always loved getting the bottles. That was like my favorite item. Right? Should I reuse it? Is for the boss? But what if you know? Huh. What's up, Space My Name? If they have to think about using it, it gives it extra flair of rarity. Oh yeah, you could buy one bottle and yeah. I wish it would show the using the bottle. Oh well. So players have something to learn in future replays. There's a bit of skill to learn. I hear ya. So okay, with the debate here is really whether to make the flasks passive or an item that you have to use. That's really the debate. So why don't we start a straw poll? Straw poll time. See what people think. How should the flask bring the player back to life? One, passively. I guess this is more like manually. Manually, must use the item. You had my attention at flasks. Or permanent bottle and timed bottle. Interesting. Huh. What are you citing like Metal Gear Solid? Oh, how did that work, good Paul? So in Metal Gear Solid 3, I know I played this. I don't really remember it though at this point. When you bite the revival pill, is that after you've already died? So like in you're dead, you're totally dead, and then you have a chance to use your revival pill after you're dead, or did you have to have used your revival pill before the death? Oh, I need a count flasks method. That's right. Let's get this compiling. Gear component. Count flasks and count cactus containers. Yeah, so it's after you've died in the boss fight with the sorrow, right? Okay. So it's just a choice then for the player. It's not really a skill. It's not really passive. It's just that you have the choice when you die. That's kind of like the middle ground between passive and active. It's like almost active, but not really. You could also have it in your inventory. When you die, you get a prompt asking if you want to revive. That would be exactly the same thing, right? Maybe Jib would, right? Play the video. It's trying to play it. What MGS3 did was, it didn't tell you that you didn't die for real. Oh. Uh-huh. Man, I know I played that whole thing, but it was like almost 10 years ago, I think. Wasn't it? It's like, I think I played that in like 2007. It's not loading it for me right now. Let me try one more time. So you click continue and you have to fight the sorrow again. Right, yeah. But it would be a no-brain action all over again. Why would someone not... Right, exactly. That's what I'm saying. Yeah, yeah. It's not skill... That's what I was saying by it's not skill-based at that point. Okay, right. He dies... Oh, I remember this now. Oh, yeah. So you could use items like on that screen still.
Boss, you have to shoot me. I can't. Shoot me. You want to finish your mission, don't you? Then you'll have to shoot me. The spirit of the warrior will always be with you. Don't be sad.
I guess it depends what you do. Want from players. If you want them to think about using the item, then I'd say put it on a timer. If you want to put it more luck based, then have it on passive. How's this drop hole doing? We gotta get more people on the stream, I guess. We'll leave it on this straw poll for now, and I'll code most of this stuff up and get it working kind of like passively, I guess, and then it'll be simple once it's all coded and animated and all that. I could switch from passive to manual easily. So we'll start doing it, and we'll save whether it's passive or manual for later. Pizza, we're trying to straw poll something here. I think I'll pass on posting it on Twitter for right now. We'll get, wait till the starts getting a little more heat. More people showing up on the stream and stuff. Yeah, I don't know. That's what I was kind of thinking, was passive makes the most sense because it's basically a Zelda-like game. Good question, though, Arcane. How so? Count flasks. Oh, this needs to be count flasks full. Oh, that's a good point too, that there are already active items like the cacti. We got 8 votes now. Nice. And thanks for the follow. I think it was somebody following there. I'm not sure what that sound effect was, but thank you for following. Right. So we need to count full flasks. And empty. Oh. That's crazy. I thought your six was kind of like an artistic way of doing an L or something. The Twitch alerts is a bit big on the stream, was it? It's not still there, is it? I'll have to look at that later when I'm setting this stuff up. Thanks for letting me know. I know, right? Yeah. Hey, what's up, Narcos? Doing good, man. How are you doing? Okay, let me see, make sure I did all that right. Count cactus containers, gnome cactus containers, item, empty flasks, flasks, empty, full flasks, flasks, full. Okay, good. All right, back to health system. Here's where we choose to come back to life. If we have flasks, count flasks, or count full flasks. Oh, this is Paul Six. Oh, what's up, Paul Six? No way. I remember your name from back then. And it, oh, whoops. Oh no, I pressed some weird buttons. All of a sudden I lost my chat. I feel lost without my chat. Oh. Set screen, new screen loading, this new texture loader, this new screen loading, this new map set loader, new screen logo. Wow. Oh, hey, I got back to my other window. Nice. You started to understand code? Awesome, pizza. Right on. Okay, here we can come back to life. Otherwise, we do the death flux. Okay, so simple stuff here would be, first of all, we need to remove one of the full flasks and make it an empty flask, turn it into an empty flask, and then we need to just come back to life too. So it does play the render death, I think. Anim's death, here it is. This runs, yeah, it plays the sound effect for the death, sets the animation, and oh, also makes it like that. It makes sure it's not overwritable. Okay, so we want it to run the death animation, and then the player revives. So we need a revive animation. I'm just going to do something simple here quickly to get a revive animation. We'll take the death animations, all of them. Or no, I guess they're called release. Ooh, they're all disorganized. Damn. We need these all together. All right, we got the release all set up. Let's put this actually as this right up there. Okay, so yeah, every animation in this game has like 5 animations basically, because the player can not have your hat, the hat and all that. I didn't really implement an armor system in this game, and I think that will be something as part of like Songbringer 2 or 3 or whatever. If there's that, you know, if I get to that point and get to make those games, I'm definitely going to do some kind of cool armor system where you can change out, have different kinds of swords and different armor and, you know. Okay. So we need a copy of that. And we'll call it Revive. And we'll reverse all these. Okay. So now we should have a revive animation. And I guess we'll just play. I guess all we need to do is set the next animation. Okay, so E render. Give it points. Set animation. Animation. Repeat 0. So it runs the death animation, and then after that it runs the revive animation. So that's going to be render system get anim key for this entity. We want whatever direction and skin and all that. We want revive, and we don't repeat that either. And I think I want the player to stay dead for a moment, and then come back to life. So, we'll see how long that is. We'll get this string key, and then get the NM for it too. Waiting for 4K, nice. Oh, you lost your points? Oh, how many did you lose? Oh. Wasn't that many? Profile get anim nope, it's profile up profile get animation key skin. Okay, so if we have this revive animation, we're gonna run it and schedule a function to run after a certain delay. So the delay is going to be an m get duration. Okay, so after this, we can bring the player back to life. So we have an e in here. Nope. Capture that. Okay, so we bring the player back to life. System int. Now this isn't going to be all at once. This will be an animation where the player is like bringing, getting healed and everything. So, but for now, I'm just going to do max. So f dot l dot max HP. And that should be it. That should be all we need to do. Well, I don't know. We'll see. Okay, let's hope that those mechanics work there. You got like $60 on Steam? Nice, man. Oh, nice salad dogs. Yeah, man. Ha, nice. It worked, I guess. It didn't change the player's health, though. I guess we could just set the. We would go game scene, set life, f dot health dot HP. Oh man, the player got hit again during. I think he got hit again while he was already dead. Wayne's World reference where? Wayne's World, Wayne's World, party on, excellent. Woo! Here, on hurt. Wait, no, we don't want on hurt even. What the hell happened that time? This is where it applies elements, panic, poison. It's like. Change HP overall, accumulates all its HP delta. I'm wondering if it if the player is already dead here. Oh yeah, if the player's not alive, it doesn't do anything. Oh, I guess we would want to change HP to be positive. Probably. Yes. I guess it'd be better to just go health system change HP for this entity. Oh, I guess we do need to know how many hit points though. HP delta, health.hp, changer, no changer. Hopefully that'll make the like health increase sound this time. Yeah, you need 1,000 to raffle a Steam key for a 25% chance. Okay, it's that time. It did not bring the player back to life. And it definitely needs to wait a second too before it runs the revive. Or the revive could just have a lot of blank frames at the beginning. Okay, let's see what happens here. Oh, did it kill the health component? No. Does it have an invincible timer? Show me the invincible timer. What's wrong with you, debugger? Oh, man. Really? The health component was empty? It'll only take 33 days. People have done it. People have done 4,000 before. I think, who did it? Is it Pedro? Okay, step inside. Step inside. Yeah, it's empty if it has no hit points and no flags. No max hit points, no flags. And it has max hit points, so return value here should be false. Okay, which means that health invincible timer must already be going. It's just not showing me the value, but that's probably what it is. Oh, here we go. Where did it return? Oh, that time the invisible timer wasn't going. Oh, let's just make sure the invisible timer is not it. Oh, good point. Good point. Yes, good, Paul. You are correct. Not equals on a floating point value is not deterministic. Not guaranteed to be deterministic. But in my experience, it mostly is. I don't know why. But in my experience, if you're on the same platform, the not equals always performs the same. It's only when you compare it to different platforms, like Windows will handle equals 0.00000000001. Windows will handle that different than Mac, for example. But I've always seemed to have found that Windows always handles it the same way, and Mac always handles it the same way. It's just that when you compare the two platforms together, that's the only real difference. But I think logically and reasonably, it's safe to assume, though, that good Paul, you're correct there, that you should never really trust a floating point number equals equals. All right, we got HP Delta 0. Oh man, this whole time I was passing in 0 for the delta. All right. Low. Doubles technically, really? I should work for the most part. Right, with double? Yeah. Interesting. I have found double to be better performance for me in a couple key situations, which used to cause my player to jitter a little bit, actually. When I switched from floating point to double, the player stopped jittering. Okay, so there's a lot more I want to go on here. I want to do a sweet animation, basically. And I think I want the HUD to fade out and the lens to zoom in. Think if I die this last time, I'm actually dead. Oh no, I had one left. Let's make sure. It just keeps using it forever. Oh, because I forgot to remove the. Remove a full flask and add an empty flask. Lua, for example, uses doubles to represent all numbers, and it's perfectly fine to use Lua numbers like integers. Really? Huh. I did not know that. I really love how simple Lua is. Okay, so loop over. The full flasks. I guess we'll make this an item. Item type I, starting at K, flask full one. I guess we could do J. Let's just do item type, item, K item none, and then yeah, I will just be zero. I guess if you're really concerned about precision issues, you could always do something like if value epsilons. Yeah, making that a nice little function would be good. That would, yes, it does. That's what sometimes I've seen done in like professional games and all that, you know, that you come to the conclusion that, whoa, that test does not quite work. You add a little epsilon and that really can solve everything for you right there. Or you can use L round F a lot. I do that a lot. Actually, I'm always writing things as integers. And if you look at everything, this is kind of my answer to using integer based floating points. So I go, my v3fs and my everything is based on this one class called intfloat. And intfloat is an instance of intval. And basically all intval does is it takes a floating point number and then divides it by 1,000. If you have a floating point number, it multiplies it by 1,000 and stores that as an integer. So the precision of this number is really not as important as it being represented as an integer all the time, right? So basically what this whole class does is it takes a floating point value and stores it as an integer. And then whenever you want to use it as like a normal floating point, it always just automatically casts itself back into a floating point for you. Here it is, operator V. Is return v value times the divisor. So it takes the integer value and multiplies it by the divisor to give you that, you know. But anyways, I did this because I've written multiplayer games before, and it's really important to have things as integer based as possible because of that determinism issue between cross-platform. What's up, Yame? Oh, yeah. All right, and here we go. Item equals item type. Oh. Start with flask full one, and then every time we increment, we go item plus one. There. Now we can count the item. Or, yeah, if it's greater than one, the first one we come across, we e gear. Has item minus equals one and break. Okay, there. That'll remove one full flask. Now we need to add one empty flask. Starting with one, if it is zero, ooh, starting to see the flaw in this system here. We're using two different items. It's probably would be a lot better to do a flask, which has a quantity of value 2 would be full and a quantity of value 1 to be empty. Because I'm seeing this right here. This is a bad design. Because I can technically what a player could have is a player could have 3 empty flasks and 3 full flasks. And that would mess all this up. So anyways, I'm going to store that in my mind for a moment and just see if this works, basically. Yeah, so add a flask, add an empty, remove a full flask, revive. Okay, so yeah, if you're just joining the stream, I'm working on an item that brings you back to life. It revives you. It's called it's the flask, and you can have 3 of them, and you can refill them. I'm working on the mechanics of it right now. So the player does do a little revive animation, but it's just the opposite of the death animation. So it doesn't look good yet. I'm just working on, like I said, the mechanics, the programming part of it first. He just bounces back to life, but okay, this time I should be able to die. That was 2. I've been revived twice so far. This will be the 3rd revive. And then this, I'll die 1 more time, and I should not be able to die. I mean, I'll be permanently dead. Yeah! Nice, it worked. And if I continue, I should still have the flasks. Oh no, it used up the flasks. It didn't restore them. I need to write this down in my notes. It was streaming while buffering? What? Yeah, but it's a rare item. It's a rare item, first of all, to even get a flask. And secondly, you have to refill it. Have him revive like that in Chuck Norris mode? Really? It looks cool that way? I was thinking of something way cooler. Oh yeah. Okay, so I need to consider making flasks quantities replenish on continue. I don't know. Yeah, I guess I'm kind of with Teak here. You probably should not be able to get the flasks. Let's see how that straw poll is doing. Hey, we got a straw poll. Hey. Yes, I'm programming on a Mac. Right, a lightning strike? I mean, I could do a lightning strike real easy. I already have lightning. Okay, next up, we'll get it so we can see the flask in the inventory. That'd be a good thing. So right now we have these 3 items, but we don't know what any of them are, and it doesn't combine them all together either. You think manually, so you don't waste your stack if they don't get back after death. No, the passive way Oh wait, Nathanael, you don't waste your stack if they don't get back after death. Oh, I hear you, right? So if they were manual use, you could choose whether to use it or not, basically. Yeah, so if you weren't doing that good. Huh, such an interesting question, right? This will really play into how difficult the game is as a player. If you have flasks, the game is a lot less difficult. So that becomes like a choice. As you're playing the game, you will get to choose how difficult the play is. If you want a more difficult play, just don't pick up the flask. That's kind of how Dark Souls does it. You get that one item in Dark Souls, and basically it makes everything a lot easier. What was that called? I forget, there was an extra credits video on it. Yeah, it's like tooth. I like them both. I like Visual Studio, and I like Xcode too. Xcode's kind of, it's got this quick open feature, which is pretty rad. But it kind of, there's a couple real sucky things about it though. The biggest sucky thing is that it includes the entire SDK that you're using in the quick open. Like I type in CON, I want to see constants.h, which is my file in my project. But no. It wants to show me conf.h from kernel sys, which I have never opened. And will never purposefully open, probably. It's like Xcode designed this pretty cool tool, but really messed it up by forcing you to have to put your whole SDK in the quick open. And I actually started a brand new project just to check this out. I was like, okay, I'm gonna start a brand new project with nothing in it, the simplest project in the world. And it always includes this. Anyways, I'm ranting. I'm sorry. I'm ranting about this. We need some graphics. We need a graphic for the flask. Let's get a picture of a flask as some inspiration to start with. It'll become too easy if you can just die when things get hard and then rewind. Oh, and also, yeah, it's easier to play if you're ranged. That's right. That's a choice at the beginning. Oh, those are cool, right? You guys seen those with the foldable cup? The beaker's kind of cool. But it wouldn't work. All right, that one works okay, I guess. Get the HUD open. Add some HUD, add a HUD sprite for these flasks so we can actually see them. This is gonna be awesome. So awesome. Really? Is that what they are? Erlenmeyer flasks? I did not know that. I call them beakers. What they should do is add to the options menu of Xcode and limit the search tool. Totally! Yes! Oh, that'd be so great. Yes, Psychtooth. Oh my god, I wish they would do that. So in Visual Studio, is it the same way? Is it the same thing? Like your quick open in Visual Studio, does it also include everything you don't want? Let's see, T. Loading, loading. Nice cookie, man. Swarmody. Oh yeah, Swarmody Explorer. I know. I wish they would change it too. I wish they would fix it, or just adding a tiny little option. That's all we want. All we want is a tiny little option that says don't include the whole SDK in my open quick folder. Some open quick leaf preferences would be sweet. Oh, but in Visual Studio you can change it. Oh, that's really nice. Really, the front end has gone down, huh? Yeah, Xcode's free, yay. Nice, that's cool. They do it right in Visual Studio. Okay, so we need like a icon that's like 12 pixels around. Maybe 14. Whoa. Yeah, totally. Throw a bunch of programmers at it. Really, they switched it to .NET? Oh. Man, so I started using Visual Studio really just like last year, but that was after a 10-year hiatus. So the last time I actually coded in Visual Studio was like 2002. 2002. Yeah, and back then it was faster. It was a lot faster. Then that, of course, because they, yeah. But I don't know. I guess I'm not a really good example because I went all the way from 2002 to 2014 even before I really started using Visual Studio again. Oh, that's nice. Yeah. You were 6 years old? Oh, that was nearest neighbor. All right, well, let's take it. Image mode. Let's get this down to like six colors, and we'll draw our own after we get all this done. Right HUD, top hat. Okay, so there is the dirty version. Oh yeah, they still have Visual Basic. They don't have Basic anymore, Visual Basic? It's called Basic.net. I know, it did run horrible. Actually, I think Visual Basic was something I used before I even used Visual C++ when I was first learning and everything. I was really lucky, actually. We had this developer friend or whatever that actually gave me his copy of Visual Studio. No, it was Visual C++ back then. It was just Visual C++. Like you had to separately buy Visual Basic and Visual C++, and I think they were both like $300. It was definitely not cheap. Oh, does my tablet work again? Come on, tablet. Come back to me. Yeah, oh, my tablet's working today. Awesome. Oh man, I feel like a new artist. Can like draw quickly again. This is great. All right, I have no idea what this is going to look like until I put it in the game. Let's just call that Flask. Make this a new layer base slice. Name it HUD item Flask. I guess I could just call it item Flask. Okay, let's see what it looks like. VB6, yeah! I know, horrible variable storage types, right? Variant? Oh, and big variables? I forgot about big variables. Oh, big variables. It totally makes me laugh thinking about it now. Oh my gosh. Really? You had to crack Visual Studio. Whoa. It is. AOL chatbots. Right? No, good, Paul. What I'm doing here is I'm exporting this into separate ping files. So that's what this screen is right here. This is sliced all up, right? Every one of these little images here is sliced inside this overall document and saved separately as separate ping files. And then they're all compiled together into a texture using Sprite Pack or Texture Packer. Yeah. What's up, Zelda Ethan? Did Songbringer release? No, it's going to be later this year. Yeah, Songbringer is coming out later this year. It's still in beta. Okay, let's make sure this is only user slices. And we should have one new file. Item Flask. All right. Now we can go to constants and give this thing some images. What version control? I'm using Git. Yeah, you probably just see it. You just saw me use Git here. I use Git. I actually love Git. I've used SVN before. I really think Git's more simple and powerful, personally. But, you know, I'm not trying to start a flame war or anything. SVN's cool, too. You could even use CVS for all I care. All I think is you just need to be using some kind of version control system. It really doesn't really matter what version control system you're using, as long as you're using a version control system. You just watched a video on Undertale? Nice. Undertale animation? Cool. Do you use Walgreens? Fried dumpling? What made you share these videos? All right, we need to also hook up some text. Yeah, this is the one. All right, we need item. Flask empty. Wait, is it flask empty or is it flask empty one? Oh, it's flask empty one. Empty flask. It's a void waiting to be filled. Flask full. I think that's about what a flask full of spirits passively revive when losing all courage, something like that. You made your own VCS? No way! Oh, guess I didn't have any more flasks. Okay, so they're too bright for starters. I'll make a less bright, but it's kind of good actually. The art, I like the art so far. Now I gotta get them to combine together. And they need to look a little different when they're full, too. So if I had, let's say, one full one, two empty ones. I just thought that I thought of something here. If the player has, if I combine them into two items, it might be a little difficult about how it displays the empty flask versus the full flask. In fact, it would. It would need to be two separate items for it to work correctly, I think. Win G! Win G! Oh my gosh, I forgot about Win G! Yeah, before DirectX. That's right, I forgot all about Win G, man! Oh. How do I plan on people preventing from editing their saves? For now, I'm not at all doing that. I want everybody in during the beta to be able to edit their save files in case, just in case, you know. When the game goes fully released, I'm gonna make it so it uses like a, you know, some kind of encryption or whatever on the save files. Wow. I guess the empty flask could be on its side. Let's make the full flask a little darker. Why is the Songbringer still open? Yeah, this should be a little darker. Wingy, yeah, Wingy was not used that much because back at that time, before DirectX came out, most gamers or game developers were still making their games for DOS. From what I remember of that time, I was making games at that moment. That's right when I started making video games, was 1994 to be exact. And yeah, so back then, most people still released their games for DOS. So WinG was kind of like the precursor to DirectX, which that's why it wasn't really that used yet. You had to stream open twice? Is that why it was a buffering or something? Minus 30. I feel like it can go farther. Maybe minus 50. Let's try minus 50. I'm really happy I sped up my build yesterday. I found a few little tweaks here and there, and I got my overall build time for Songbringer, which has 62 files, one prefix header. I got the overall build time down from 58 seconds to like 42 seconds. That's a complete rebuild from scratch. And then on the rebuild, like for example, if only a header changes, that I got all the way down to 25 seconds. So I'm really happy now that it builds faster whenever I change a header. You know, if you change one CPP file, it compiles real fast. It doesn't look much darker. It looks really white still. Did it compile? Did it? What? Let me have it. Yeah, it does look like it compiled it. Okay. Well, let's make it darker then. Image adjust. What? Oh, was that saturation? Oh, duh, it was saturation. I feel like really foolish here. Image adjustments. This time, let's do the lightness instead of the saturation. Oh, that makes it look crazy bad on top. Okay, what I want to do is like really only edit that much of the image. I've been making games since you were 4. Whoa, nice, right? It's crazy. I know there's people here on the stream that I've been coding longer than they've been alive. Rocket Bunny, for example, is only 13 years old, which means he was born in 2003. I started coding 10 years before he was born. Man. Compression-oriented programming. Tell us about this compression-oriented programming. Steve Tramby? You're talking about, what did I change? Or was that on yesterday's stream? What was it? You mean, are you talking about Brutus? Something about Brutus here you're talking about? I've been improving his code a lot, actually. And his, I got an idea for Brutus, too. I think I'm going to make him Brutus so he... The first time you meet Brutus, he'll be killing enemies on the screen. Like he'll right when you come on the screen, he'll be killing one last enemy, and there's like a bunch of like dead bodies. So it just shows how cool Brutus is. Compression-oriented programming. Can you give me the like the one sentence version? Give me the I'm streaming and I can't read all this right now version. How do you Can you sum up compression-oriented programming for me? Oh, the build time improvements? Yeah, I was doing that yesterday. I figured that wouldn't be that interesting to most people, but like really the way I found all these things is I basically made it here, I'll show you basically what I changed. Most interestingly here, this one thing I changed in build, every time it builds Songbringer, it like runs through all the assets and makes sure everything is all good. And it increments the build version and it copies this updates the sprite sheets and copies in fonts if it needs and converts MP3s and updates shaders and everything. But, one thing that was really slowing that down is I was using an extra call to get the base name of a file. I was going like base name file or whatever, something like that. And that was forking off a different process every single time. So what should take 1 second was taking 2 seconds. So basically I streamlined the build. So this is 2 seconds of my life though, every single time I ever build. So basically I just saved myself many seconds every day. That was pretty cool. But then the other build time improvements are basically all just like for example, let's go to AI system. Instead of before I had one big blanket thing, it was called include headers, and that included everything. But not every file needs everything, so I went through every single CPP file and made sure it was only including the things that it needed. And that's what improved the build time so much overall. Compression-oriented programming basically amounts to avoiding over-planning things. You just start coding and let the code itself show you how it should be organized. Yes! Yes! I love it. That's how I code. Yeah, Brutus, right? Write it all up in pseudocode, then afterwards figure out how to refine it. Skip the pseudo, yeah, skip pseudocode. I would too. Yeah, oh, and I also simplified the prefix too. So the prefix used to be, oh, that's the iOS one. The prefix used to be a lot more complicated because it included all my headers. Basically, it included the headers file, headers.h, which included everything else. But now it only includes kit, which basically includes Cocos 2D. So, and the ST standard library. So basically, this is only the prefix is only things that are really concrete that rarely change. So that also saves a good 4 to 5 seconds because it takes a while to build the prefix header. So if you can get away with not having to rebuild your prefix header, all the better. So that's why it only does things that it needs to here. And surprisingly, it didn't slow down the build at all much by taking a lot of things out of the prefix header, which is crazy. But it actually helps a lot to on rebuilds. Okay, so I was working with making this darker, but like sort of selectively, like maybe like that. Sort of a little gradient here. Gradient, sorry, I said gradient again. Oh, that goes against everything you were taught at school? Oh man, no, definitely don't overthink things. Use your heart, man. Use your heart when you're coding. Seriously, that's what my advice is. Follow your heart with your code because your head will often get you into these crazy situations where you overthink things. You take too long planning out how you're going to build a system or how you're going to start something. You take too long thinking about how to start something, and you waste so much time. But if you just get started, quite often you realize the things that you need to know so that you can design the right system. So in my experience, I like to start something immediately, just do it however the heck I can. And then a few hours into it, I'll be like, you know what? I can do this better now. Now that I understand it, now that I've created a system that's kind of working, I can think of how I would design a better system. So I design a better system and then I'm done for that day. And I end up having a good system and the thing that I wanted to do done instead of overthinking it, you know? Yeah, so much ideology is either bad or not universalizable. Okay, so hopefully that looks a little better, darker. I just realized the thing, like, what's the word? I'm gonna check the line count. Now that I did all these changes, I added a bunch of lines of code by having to do all these headers separate. But it's way faster building. Oh, and see, I didn't even really increase the lines that much. It's still at 55,000. I've really got to find a way though to improve or to shorten up area, which is almost 5,000 lines, and flux, which is almost 5,000 lines. Area creation and area patterns also is quite big. These I can reduce by making more things more data driven. Flux, I'm not sure exactly. I might have to split that up into several different files. I don't know. Let's see if that looks better. Oh, frag boog is, sorry, what's the difference? What's the difference between an S-lock? I think it's total line count because it's actually compiling, it's looking at, Oh, that looks a lot better with that gradient. Here's my command I'm using. I'm using word count dash L for the lines. Which I think just counts the exact lines. So if like I think you're talking about S-lock. What's it? Help me define S-lock. Is that source lines of code? Source plus comments. It's source plus white space. Yeah. This is plus comments and white space. That counts. So yeah, I guess I would need a more sophisticated word counter if I were to, or line counter if I were to, I don't know how I would actually take a look at the source, the exact lines without the white space and the comments. Yeah, so it's probably a lot less. It's probably like 40,000 actual lines of code, or maybe 30, I don't know. Okay, I did like this a lot better like that. This is a good drawing now, I like it. Okay, so I'm thinking the empty flask is just tilted on the side. And I need to redraw it though. Let's make sure this layer gets set up. This is item flask empty. Whoa. Why is it so big? What? What is this? Oh, Eclipse has a plugin for that? Oh, that would be nice for the Xcode, right? You don't like the UI? What's wrong with the UI? Tell me about it. Yame, I would love to hear. What is it about the UI that you don't like? Because I would love to make it better myself. I got some ideas. Right. Yeah. Joe Fish. Talking to a brick wall. I know. That's what I think too. Totally. Huh? That's a quote from Bill Gates. Is it too dark? I think it contrasts with the rest of the game. Okay, so the rest of the game is like lighter. Let's take a look at that again. So here we are in the game. It's sort of light, but this is the light part of the game. It's not nighttime. We're in a nice friendly area. And so you're saying this is too dark right here? Or it's a little too dark for you, your opinion? I was actually considering, I'm not sure, this would kind of take away from the whole Zelda vibe, but I was considering making this actually just a clear view so you can see behind and you can see through to the game. I don't know. Huh. So we got most votes are going for passive use of the flask so far. Okay, what the heck happened to this layer? Right? I'm not going crazy. This layer's that big. I go layer, new layer base slice. Oh, like me, I forgot to do the layer base slice part. Okay. Item flask. Empty. All right, now I just got to redraw it so it looks right. Right. Same is true of Walmart. They didn't try to oppress competition anymore. I know, right? Joe Fish? Yeah, it makes sense how a company becomes mediocre. All right, let's try that. Playing around with that too much. HUD. And then constants. This is going to become item flask empty. Laziness is a virtue. Yeah. Same will eventually happen to Apple, I think, but more slowly. Hyper-focused? Oh, that looks horrible. That doesn't even look like an empty flask. Horrible. Okay, let's try another one, but this time let's just make it darker. Or flip it. I'll flip it horizontally too. Okay. Left, right. Right. Not dark enough. I don't like it flipped. You can't blame him. Actually does kind of make sense to keep them all separate. I just wish they would change color maybe or something. Like maybe the lighter one changes hue. Whoa! Maybe it like turns all gold like that. It's kind of cool. 87. Maybe a little darker. Wow, that really changes it all. I don't know if I like the lightness changing. Right? Right. Oh, how to treat his, I know. Right? Yeah, it needs some kind of color. I think this looks a lot better with like a full flask just being colored and an empty flask just being dark. You know, it doesn't make sense actually logically, but it does visually. Oh, you could have the cap missing. That's a good idea. Yeah, maybe the cap is like off or something on this other one. Oh, good idea. Okay, so we go to the empty flask layer and draw it with its cap off. So like it would look something like this, like the cap is just hanging there. And it needs a little bit more of a darker part here in the center. Well, maybe there. It looks weird changing the color of the bottle cap. Oh, I guess I could leave that alone. Joe Fish, this is about a year and a half into making Songbringer. Light refracting. Well, yeah. I don't know, I'll try it. It's filled with radioactive superpowers. Ecto cooler. Right, the ecto cooler. It didn't recompile. Oh man. Why not? I thought you were supposed to rebuild. Let's run it again. No, oh, still didn't. Maybe I didn't export it. Come on. Well, I'm kind of lazy today. It's Sunday. I don't think I'm able to get that much done on today's stream. Why isn't it doing it? Let me check the build log again. Come on, build. Did you it didn't compile the asset, did it? What if I run the script manually? Suddenly it doesn't work anymore. Okay, re-export. Oh, it's raw pack. That's what I want to run. Or Surge Soda, right? Surge! Yeah. I am lazy coding today. I'm not that as fast as I normally am, that's for sure. Yeah, I think it just rebuilt the textures that time. Or no, I already did. Yeah. There we go. Now the cap is off. Yeah, it looks pretty off. I guess it could be a little darker. Yeah, let's make that hole a little bit darker. That does look good. I like the cap off suggestion. Nothing. I guess Hammerspoon died or something. Come on, Hammerspoon. Okay, if I rebuild, it should repack the textures. It is this time. Okay, Hammerspoon must have died. I don't know what's up with Hammerspoon sometimes. It's supposed to auto detect when any file in a certain directory changes, and then I can run a script whenever that happens, which just touches the directory so it can rebuild next time. But anyways, it doesn't work sometimes. Throws me for loops like this where I'm like, did it work? No, did it work? My pixel art is like Google Images, Photoshop, small amount of colors, minor fixes. Not always. No, no, no. This is more for real objects, right? When I'm trying to draw something, usually what I'll do is I'll redraw it too. That time I got lazy and I totally just took the image and drew some pixels over it until it looked a little cleaner. But usually what I do is I actually, if I'm going to use a reference image like that, I'll put the reference image to the side. And then I'll draw it again, kind of in a more pixel art style. So yeah, when I'm lazy though, I'll just take an image like that and then just mess it with it until it looks right in the game. Just kind of making it, you know, pixel art the cheap way. Ah, it's still not dark enough though. Thanks, Paul. It is a lot. It's very nice to work for myself instead of a studio, AAA, or I mean, I guess working for an indie studio would be totally different. Yeah. I've mostly worked for, I worked for studios before they were even called indies, but yeah, I guess they're all indies. Trilobite even was kind of Trilobite actually was AAA. Okay, that looks great. It looks great. I think I like it like that. I'll maybe mess with the color a little bit before I'm done, but that looks pretty good to represent a flask. And I'm thinking that you will actually kind of like in Zelda, you had all three of your bottles as separate items, so you could see what was in them. Like each bottle could have something else in it. But I'm thinking it will be the same thing. So this will say empty flask. This one will say empty flask, and this one will say full flask. So you can have, it will have all three of them separate. It never tries to combine the two items into one. Like, for example, like the bomb container, it combines multiple of them into one item in your inventory. So yeah, that's it for today's stream, basically. I just got flasks basically working. I mean, you can die and it brings you back to life. I need to work on the animation though, and I wanted to zoom in. Do like cool animation, and then I gotta also hook up the code so you can buy, you know, refill your flasks and placing the flasks throughout the world and stuff like that. So there's a lot left to do to get this new feature working. Yes, I have heard about Stardew Valley. Stardew Valley, we talked about it on a few streams. Yeah, one guy, but he also had a publisher, so not quite one guy, but yeah. He did all the R code and music, which is awesome. I really look up to him. I looked up to anybody else that makes their own games like that, man. It's just, I got a lot of respect for that. Really? I never knew that about triple A's. Huh. Wow, if that was a definition of AAA, then Trilobite definitely was AAA. They had like, I think like 60 employees at some point, at one point. And that was the 90s. But yeah, anyways, so I'm pretty lazy today. I'm going to call it quits for the stream today. So it was good seeing y'all. And thanks for watching and everything. And I'll be back next time with more Songbringer development. That's it for today. Yes, I would love to see Songbringer on the Steam Top Sellers for a month. That would be awesome. That would be so cool. I'm hoping. We'll see. So cheers, you guys.